dwelling rare?
Relatively rare compared to all the other dwellings, yes. And we call them cliff dwellings as opposed to caves. They're generally inside of what we call an alcove as opposed to a true cave. So it's just cut back naturally, and there's no actual like caves branching off all over the place. So that's why they're cliff dwellings, because they're built up on these cliffs.
Are there any dwellings that are in caves?
Yeah, there have been things found in caves, yes. The building materials that they used, you see, now again, Park Service does this, but in the original walls up here, it's the same thing. It's the same rock, just these blocks of rock. They're essentially a natural brick of a type at varying sizes. That's how they built all these. So where did they get all that kind of material from? And how did it all get up in here? Any thoughts?
Hiked it up.
God, I'm glad I didn't have to do that. No, believe it or not, the rock was here. If you look at parts of the geology above us, you'll see these striations, these bands that are nothing but like flat flakes of this rock material. And as it decayed over the eons, pieces just start breaking off. You won't see chisel marks. They didn't really chisel here. You go to some types of dwellings, like up in Mesa Verde, they're going into either sandstone or limestone, and they're chiseling into the mountainside to make their dwellings. Here, there's a bunch of this rock just laying in this alcove that had fallen, you know, centuries before, probably.
So it's all natural.
So it's pretty much all natural rock that was laying around that they moved around and turned into walls, and they cemented it all together using Arizona's caliche soil, which just happens to be mixed with certain other ingredients that are all found right here, makes essentially a cement, or you know, like a plaster. But you can just layer these up, put in some more wet cement, layer them up, more wet cement, and this guy turns into walls and into structures all of a sudden. So fortunately, they didn't have to haul that kind of stuff up here. Now they would need a lot of water, because you've got to mix that soil with water to make it malleable. And then once it's hardened and dried, if it doesn't get wet, it pretty much stays there. It's kind of like concrete at that point. This was a very laborious task, but they believe, based on evidence, that they probably started building this upper dwelling and the lower dwelling around the early 1300s and lived in them through the early 1400s. So 100 to 130-ish years or so, possibly living in these dwellings, building and living in them. They did not build all the rooms at once. This was, let's build a place and now we're going to live here. And maybe the family expands and now we're building another room or something like that. Or maybe there's groups of people and then they started to build more. But there's some evidence that they would build this and then this and then this and then this. You can just kind of tell those that know architecture, they can say, yeah, this had to be here before this was added and then this was added. And slash floors for the second story, because some of this was two stories. So again, a lot of this is absolutely original, untouched. Okay, so back in here, you can see where there was some repair work many years ago, because this wall up above me was buckling out. So there's a chunk of metal with some bolts sticking out. There's another one down here you can't see. Piece of wood there with a bolt sticking out. They tie into something behind it to try to keep it from falling out. Nowadays, we don't do that kind of stuff. This was done decades ago. We try to keep it as natural as possible. The look, so if you look at it, it looks like it matches pretty well. But we don't do this anymore nowadays either. But it's been left here. Now it's kind of part of history, early history for the Park Service. But this was also put in to help keep that wall from falling and buckling out any further. Now, this wall, which, sorry, we used to be able to bring people right into here, but we can't now, is doing that same thing. It's starting to buckle out. And so they've temporarily put braces to help keep it from falling. They have to determine how they're going to work with this one. In the end, it may come down. but everything up here is original. Remember I talked about the sorrel cactus, the skeleton, the ribs? That's what these guys are here. So you can see they collected and used a lot because there's a lot of two-story parts of each of the dwellings. And so this is common in their construction. Here's a typical beam, pretty good size. Below that, there would have been at least one in this room, maybe two big posts. They're even bigger. And so they use a post and beam type construction.
So what we've got right here is there's a small piece of corn. Here is a shard, top of a gourd, and then that would be a plug that they would chew on. You know, all in these outsets is all kinds of different cool stuff that's out there. And one of the things that I read about was a cistern that was here, and they said this cistern would carry 100 gallons. And so, because this is a flowstone original, so they would have had an area that they would have been able to store water, which would have been extremely neat considering what they had to do to get up that hill. So and when you've got the a built-in cistern, that's a pretty neat deal. Now, one thing that's really interesting to me is that we have pretty big rooms. So what were these rooms built and where were they around? That's a large building. It would be more, looks like some type of ceremonial. Now, one thing he talked about that was really interesting to me was that it was not a defensive position. So if it's not a defensive position, this would have been a lot of work to get up here. The thought process was is because it would have made it living more comfortable up here, considering how hot it would have gotten in the winter and how cold it would have gotten in the winter and how hot it would have gotten in the summer, and this would have been a more comfortable place. The only thing that kind of throws me on this, even though the Sanaa were 100,000 people, is that the amount of work and effort it would have taken to get up here. Now, the thought process could be possibly that they would have been in such good shape that really wouldn't have been a deterrent to live up here, and the pluses that you would have got out of it would have outweighed. But it makes me think a lot about, you know, the different setup and the different systems of why they would have been up here. But it's a different thought process. I kind of like that. I mean, you know, maybe because of their ability to be able to hike and to go up the hill because they were brought up on these hills, and it would have been a lot easier for them. This wouldn't have been a big major task for them to come up here. But the Salt River would have been right there where the lake is right now. And the Signagua is basically means salt in Spanish. So there was salt in that water basically. But boy, it would have been a major deal to come up here. Now, with the cistern, it would have made it a lot easier. I mean, you know, it would have been a lot easier to be able to have water up here. But, you know, the reality of it means, I don't know. It just, you know, were the Sanaa people the people that people feared? Because they definitely had blind sights of being able to see different locations. And it's just hard to say. Well, if you look at the video at Roger's Trough, one of the things you're going to find out is you got the same similar roof that's still intact here. And you start to realize what a treat Roger's Trough actually is when you can actually say that in the middle of nowhere you have this location with a original roof. And that would have been the soil with the caliche in it, and here's the pieces of the cactus right here, right, as they go across these beams. And it would have been a center beam here. But the ability to be able to structure two stories, it's pretty unbelievable. And then you get to some of the pueblos, which are three stories. It's very fascinating. I mean, it really is. With the doorway, it would lay on the floor because the cold air would sink to the floor. So the building would stay cooler as you went through it. And I find that amazing when you look at the general construction of these facilities and the wall system. And again, you know, I still in my head, I can't get over that this didn't have some type of deterrent on someone coming up here and attacking, because look at what you would have had to gone up. So the battling, and you know, but there's still no remnants of any type of warfare that they've found yet. Doesn't mean it didn't happen, but they haven't found anything, as I understand. So isn't that incredible that this would be such a defensible position, but not needed for it? And it makes me wonder if this group of people at 100,000 strong in their heyday in this area, right? Maybe we're the ones that you had to worry about. Maybe they were the ones that, you know, but wouldn't they have caches of all kinds of instruments? And again, if they had everything they needed, why would they need to come down here and why would they assault this? And so even though it was not considered to be the purpose of a defensible position, the reality of it is it was definitely defensible. And was that a deterrent enough to keep people out? You know, who knows? But I would have expected there to be more tools that would have been available that would have showed us that there was absolutely some type of warfare going on at that time. And because there's not, that kind of throws me. But what, you know, to get to come up to this upper structure, you know, was pretty incredible. It was pretty incredible. I tell you what, it was pretty neat. And what a great day it's been. You know, hey, it was great to get to go on a trail today. Wasn't that fascinating that we got to go on a trail and actually not bushwhack and not get tore up and not get bloody? And how incredible is that? You know, the beautiful thing about doing this is that somebody will open a door. You know, you open one door, you open another door, and so all of a sudden, you know, you change your direction and you're like, well, maybe these aren't purposefully built just for protection. I mean, I was so sure of that, right? But you know, it opens another door and you start to think to yourself, wow, maybe that's not true. Maybe it was the comfort of life. And maybe because again, if they're not warring and there's not warring instruments, then, you know, and there's not any mortuary evidence that happened, then you have to believe that that's the way it was. You know, I mean, it was, it's pretty incredible to even think that, you know, so maybe that's it. So we're gonna just truck on down here. Wow, I got a trail today. I've got no cat claws on the trail today. I've got no needles sticking in my legs. I've got no bruises yet. I better not say that because you know what the hell will happen. You know, one thing that I was reiterated on today was the old barrel cactus. You know, sometimes you got to hear it again to understand it, or to understand that, you know, they normally face south. So if you're out here and you can't find your direction and you find barrel cactus, it's a pretty good idea that they're going to be somewhat south. Now, I wouldn't depend on one like I was told by Ray, but, you know, he told me the same thing. You wouldn't want to depend on it. But it's just kind of cool that there's, you know, nature's little way and all the things that could have been eaten here. And, you know, he was saying that the average life expectancy was in the 40s. And depending on, you know, how much maize that you ate and how much if you got into the Tiswan, and if you figured out how the agave maybe made tequila versus some other medicinal things that somewhere down the line had to happen, then you know what? You might live a little longer. But, you know, it is nice. These trails are so nice. I mean, I'm just like, it's not like really even working to me. It's like I'm off today. You know, I'll say one thing. They did a hell of a nice job on these trails. I need these guys putting trails up at the ranch. You know, the dimensions of our ruin area were 70 by 80 by 60 deep. It's a good sized building, and there was those two large rooms. I really enjoyed those two large rooms. You know, as we walk down here and we get done coming to the end of the trail, what a great day it's been. What an awesome day it's been. How cool is this that we were able to come down here? You know, it wasn't our normal adventure. I mean, no blood. No blood. Is that an adventure? You know, on occasion it can be. So, you know, it was nice that there was no blood today. Now, would it be good for the next one? No, but you know, you can have an adventure without blood. What a great day today. I want to thank everybody that follows me on YouTube and Facebook and Black Flag Expeditions and Patreon people. And remember, we're going to have two live shows now. We're probably going to have the original one at 7 o'clock on Tuesday, but we're also going to have the Saturday show. It's going to be a little deeper, get a little weirder than the normal, just history stuff. But it all matches. You know, it's all about dotting the I's, crossing the T's. One more shot out here. Look at this beautiful sight. How beautiful is that? G.A. Shrek, Black Flag Expeditions. Man, I appreciate all of you. Adios, amigos. Keep on trucking.